Yeah, thank you very much for the introduction. As you already said, the title is a reduct-driven study of argumentation framework with collective attacks. So we're going to see a generalization of the standard Dung-style argumentation frameworks. And this was joint work with Wolfgang Dorschak, Markus Ulbricht, and Stefan Boltmann. So I'm going to start the talk with a motivating example for argumentation frameworks with collective attacks. Say you want to model your choice of travel, but you're not sure of the details yet, but you know you want to go to either Berlin or New York. You want to go for either 1 or 2 weeks, and you want to stay in a 4-star hotel or in a 5-star hotel. Now, in a standard Dung-style argumentation framework, you would probably model it something like this. So here the nodes of this directed graph correspond to the so-called arguments, and the directed edges are the so-called attacks. So for example, here you have the argument 5-star hotel attacks the argument 4-star hotel, and vice versa. Now, if you have an additional constraint of the form, if I go for 1 week, then I do not want to go to New York, you would just add one more edge from the argument 1 week to the argument New York. Okay, now the setting for collective attacks is the following. Say you have an additional constraint where you say, I cannot afford 2 weeks in a 5-star hotel in New York. Now, there's no easy way to do this with standard Dung-style argumentation frameworks without adding complicated constructions or some additional constructions. So Nielsen and Parsons came up with the idea of collective attacks. Here we have a collective attack, the red one, the argument 5-star and the argument 2 weeks together collectively attack the argument New York. So note that none of these arguments on their own would be sufficient to attack the argument New York. Okay, now that we have seen argumentation frameworks with collective attacks, now I'm going to tell you a little bit about what this talk is actually about. So argumentation, as you all know, is a key area of research with a lot of applications like in legal systems, in diagnose systems, diagnosis systems, and so on. And especially AFs, so argumentation frameworks, and ZAFs, these are these argumentation frameworks with collective attacks, are increasingly popular to formulate these knowledge bases. Now, the setting that we need the reduct in is when you say, okay, you have already have an argumentation framework, and what if we already accept some of these arguments? Do you have to come up with a whole new framework to perform the remaining reasoning on, or can you do something with it? And in 2020, Baumann, Brefka, and Ulbricht invented the notion of the reduct for standard Dung-style argumentation frameworks, and we generalized it to ZAFs. So the idea of the reduct is that if you already accept some of the arguments but are undecided about the rest of the arguments, you do not need to construct an entirely new framework, but you can use the framework that you already have, make some syntactic modifications on it, and then reason on what remains, what we call the reduct. And it turns out many of the key semantic properties carry over. In particular, what we did is we introduced the notion of the reduct for ZAFs, and then we showed that the modularization property holds, which is a way to, so to say, construct extensions bit by bit. This was also already shown for standard Dung-style argumentation frameworks, and we generalized it, as well as explanation schemes, which gives us a possibility to give an explanation for complete extensions of the framework in terms of the even length cycles. And lastly, we had a look at the connection between ZAFs and logic programs. Okay, so formally the background here is ZAF. So a ZAF consists of arguments and an attack relation, and each attack consists of a set, a non-empty set, the so-called tail, and a single argument, the head. So for example, here, the highlighted attack in red is a collective attack. A, B, and F together attack D. Now, this is not a directed graph, but this is a directed hypergraph now. And then some of the other notions that we need is the notion of attack. So we say a set attacks an argument. if there's an attack that is some subset of the argument. So for example, the set A and D attacks B because already the set containing only the argument A is sufficient to attack B. Then we also have the notion of defense that is known from standard Tungstall argumentation framework. So an argument, a set of arguments defends another argument if it attacks all of the attackers. So here in our small example, we have that the set A and D together defend D because the only attacker B is attacked by A. Then we have the notion of conflict freeness, that is a set is conflict free if it detects no argument that is in it. In particular, also our set A and D is conflict free. Note that even though there is an attack involving A and B, A on its own is not sufficient to attack D. So the set A and D is conflict free. We also have the notion of admissibility, and the set is admissible if it is conflict free and it defends all of the arguments in it. We've already seen that A and D defend the argument D. For the same reason, it also defends the argument A, since the only attacker C is attacked by D. And then we have complete extensions. We say a set or an extension is admissible if it contains all of the arguments that it attacks. Now, the set A and D that we are looking at here is not complete because also the argument E is defended because it has no attackers. And finally, we say a set of arguments is preferred if it is subset maximal admissible. Once again, A and D is not preferred because we also have the set ADE, which is also admissible and the proper superset. So for the relationships between these attacks, between these notions, we know that every preferred set is complete, every complete set is admissible, and every admissible set is conflict-free. Then for the following, we are also going to need two more notions. The attacked arguments, we denote these by this plus operator. So for the set AD, the attacked arguments are B, C, and F. And we also need the so-called range of a set of arguments. And the range of the set is just the set itself together with the arguments it attacks. So for the arguments D, A and D, the range would be A, B, C, D, and F, but not E because it's not attacked and not in S. Okay, so what we've seen now is the motivation for what we did for the reduct, why do we even do this, and the formal background for setdiff. So now I'm going to introduce the setdiff reduct. Now, this is the formal definition of the reduct. It's quite a bit, which is why I'm going to take you through it bit by bit. So as I already said, the idea here is to start with a framework, for example, the one given here, and say we accept parts of the framework, but we are still undecided about a lot of the rest of the framework. We want to construct the framework from it that we then can perform reason on. So say we accept the argument A for some reason, and now we want to see what happens with our reduct notion. So first of all, we remove all of the arguments that are in the range of the set that we are looking at here. That is A and B, because A is in the set and B is attacked by the set. Next, we remove all of the attacks where some of the arguments in the tail is attacked by our set. This cannot play a role anymore in what remains. So this would be this attack here in this example. Next, we remove the attacks where the tail is already contained in the set that we accepted. Also, these attacks cannot play a role anymore in the remaining set. Then we also remove the attacks where the head is not in the remaining framework anymore, because of course this cannot play a role as well. And then finally, this is a requirement that does not happen in this example. I'm going to show another example. And then the idea is that we just forget about all of this, and then we just reason on what is left here. So this small framework is then left, and we can then perform reasoning on it and draw more conclusions. Okay, so for a second example, let's revisit the example from the very beginning. So we have this choice of travel for the travel details, and say we decide to already stay 2 weeks. Now, we've already seen we remove the arguments in the range that looks like this. Then we remove all of the attacks that cannot play a role here. And now also this final part of the definition of the reduct comes into play. That if you see here, this attack from 2 weeks and 5 star together towards New York cannot be fully in the remaining framework, right? Because we already excluded the too weak argument, but the attack still plays a role. So we have to keep parts of it. And the parts we keep are the attack from Five Star to New York. So this is how the remaining framework then looks. And now the idea is to reason on it. Sorry. And what we mean by reason on it is captured by the notion of modularization. So modularization is a nice result that allows us to build extensions piece by piece. So say actually we decide to stay 2 weeks. Now note that only the argument 2 weeks is already admissible in this framework. So if we remove it, we have already seen what happens now. We are left with this framework. Say next we decide to go to Berlin, which is also an admissible set here. And the redux with respect to Berlin is just in this set. And then say finally we decide to stay in a 5-star hotel, which is also an admissible argument here. Then we decided on these 3 things. And now modularization guarantees us that actually the union of these 3 sets is also admissible in the original framework. I'm sorry. Okay. Now, this is already a very nice property because piece by piece, we were able to construct this extension here. Okay. Now, note that modularization also holds in the other direction. That is, if you already know that 2 weeks Berlin and 5-star together is admissible in the whole framework, then we also know that the subframeworks Berlin and 5-star, for example, are admissible in the redux with respect to 2 weeks. Note that the modularization also holds for preferred and stable semantics, but there's a bit of a catch that I'm going to tell you in a little bit. We can actually use the reduct to characterize our extensions. And a stable extension that is a conflict-free set that detects every argument that is not in it, we can characterize by saying that if you build the reduct with respect to this extension, then it has to be empty, which is actually very intuitive if you think about it, because we already reject either these arguments or accept them. So here, example, the set A, C, H, and F is stable because the reduct with respect to it is completely empty. We can also characterize admissible sets, and we say a set is admissible if every attack towards an argument in the set cannot be in the reduct, so to say. So we see A and F is admissible because this is the reduct, and we see there's no attack towards A and F in the reduct. Also complete sets we can characterize by saying a set is complete if it is admissible and no argument in the reduct is unattacked. So here, for example, the empty set is complete because we already see that here the reduct with respect to the empty set is always the original framework, and no argument here is unattacked. Sorry. Preferred extensions are admissible sets, where the only admissible set in the reduct is the empty extension. Here, the reduct with respect to B and E looks like this, and you can easily see that there can never be an admissible set in this reduct. D is self-attacking, so B and E are preferred. I'm also going to talk a little bit about the grounded extension. We can also compute the grounded extension with the reduct. So originally, the grounded extension is defined as the minimal complete extension. And to compute the grounded extension, we can take all of the unattacked arguments in the framework, then build the reduct with respect to it, and then repeat this procedure until no more arguments are unattacked. We've already seen that the empty set here is a complete extension. That means it also has to be the grounded extension of this framework. Okay, so now we are going to utilize our new reduct to define so-called explanation schemes. Explanation schemes are one way to define, to introduce explanations for setter Fs. And an explanation for us is a subset of the arguments that already, so to say, cause the extension. These were also already introduced by standard Dung-style argumentation frameworks, and we generalized these notions. So first of all, I said choices on even cycles. What are even cycles on these directed hypergraphs? So for even cycles, we consider the so-called primer graph, and we obtain the primer graph by just taking the original hypergraph and then adding simple edges to it. So we obtain a directed graph, a normal directed graph. So here, for example, the collective attack E and B towards A becomes two edges E to A and B to A. Likewise here with the blue attack. And then we just consider the arguments in the even cycles of this primer graph. So we have an even cycle A, B, E, F, and an even cycle AB. So the arguments in even cycles are just A, B, E, and F. Okay, now our explanation schemes are triples of sets of arguments E0, E1, and E2. And E0 is the grounded extension of the framework. E1 is this non-deterministic choice on the even cycle arguments that has to be conflict-free. And then for E2, we just take the grounded extension of the reduct with respect to the first two sets. So actually, the only thing that is not determined here is E1, the middle set. The other things we can compute, so to say, if we have the middle set. So as an example here, we've already seen that the grounded extension of this framework is empty. Then on this even length cycle, we can choose, for example, A and F. And then in the reduct, we can choose C and H. Another example for an explanation scheme would be we just choose B and E. And we've seen before that in this very framework, then the grounded, the reduct with respect to B and E has no more admissible sets. That means also the grounded extension is empty. So the explanation scheme here would look exactly like this. Now, why do we care about explanation schemes? The idea is here that actually complete extension of the argumentation framework can be decomposed into a successful explanation scheme. What do we know? What do we mean by this? So A, F, C, and H is complete in this framework, and it can be decomposed in the explanation scheme that we've seen earlier on, and that means that A and F actually serves as an explanation for this extension. The other thing is then determined only by A and F, also already by A and F. The last thing I want to talk about is the connection between setter Fs and logic programs. Now, note that the connection between argumentation frameworks and logic programs is already well known and was already pointed out in Dung's original paper and has since then been explored a lot of times. And we thought that logic programs enjoy a lot of reduc notions on their own. So what we tried to do is first we defined translations between setter Fs and atomic logic programs. And then we tried to apply our reduc notion to these logic programs. Now, what do I mean by an atomic logic program? I mean programs that consist of rules of this form. So all of the body literals are negated. And we have exactly one atom in the head. So no disjunctions or so. For the semantics, we consider the standard semantics. So three-value turbulent interpretations. And I'm going to talk about piece-stable interpretations that are defined in a standard way. Okay, so for the translation, consider this example. Here we see kind of a choice between A, B, and C. And then we see that D appears twice in a rule head. And in particular, note that if you kind of reverse the thinking of logic programs a little bit and think, what do you need to defeat the here D, then A on its own would not be enough because you could still derive it by the second rule. B and C on its own would not be enough. So you kind of need a mix in it, A and B to defeat, so to say, D or A and C. And this is exactly how our translation looks like. So here, the set F we obtain from this program then has this choice between A, C, and B, as you would expect. And then towards D, we have collective attacks from A and B and A and C. And these are exactly the minimum hitting sets of the body literals here. Exactly. So for each atom in the head, we have attacks towards the arguments then in the translation. Now we also define the translation in the other way. So given a zeta f, note this is the same zeta f that we just ended up with, we also take minimum hitting sets and then define rules according to this. And note that actually we ended up with the very same program as we started with. And this is not a coincidence, actually. This happens all the time. So for redundancy-free logic programs, this true translation, so if we turn it into a zeta f and then into a program again, is idempotent. So we end up with the same program, and this also holds if you start with zeta f's. What we also obtained is that the translation actually is adequate. So the complete extension of the zeta f corresponds to the p-stable models of the program. And what we then did, I'm not going to go into detail here, I'm just going to present the results in a very fast manner, is that some of the key semantic properties carry over. In particular, for the redux notion we defined for logic programs, we also have this behavior that if we accept some of the atoms, then what remains in the redux is what we can then reason on. And we also had this very nice characterization via the redux notion. Okay, so this is the conclusion already. So to summarize what we did, we introduced the redux for zeta f's. Then I talked a little bit about the modularization property for admissible, complete, preferred, and stable. So the catch that I was talking about early on for preferred and stable is that, well, of course, this also holds. You can have a preferred extension and then build the redux with respect to it. But the redux will also only contain one admissible set, and that is going to be the empty set. So building preferred extensions is kind of done in a different way. You don't start with a preferred extension, but you can actually build a preferred extension using this modularization property by using admissible sets as your building blocks, so to say. So you start with admissible sets and then build, and then you end up with a preferred extension. This is actually exactly what we saw in our example with the choice of the traveling details. We then ended up with a preferred extension that is actually also stable. Okay, what we also saw is that we can use the redux to characterize our semantics in a different way. We saw the explanation schemes that we can explain complete extensions by even length cycles or choices on the even length cycle arguments. And I gave you a very short introduction to our work with logic programs. Okay, what's next? So future work will contain computational aspects. So we didn't do any complexity analysis or something like this. And we also didn't implement the redux. What I want to say here is that the ICCMA, that is the International Argumentation Solver Competition, recently introduced a track for dynamic reasoning. That is, what if some arguments change? And this is in the very, very same ballpark as the idea of this whole redux. And finally, we could also generalize semantics that have been defined in terms of the redux. In particular, weak admissibility comes to mind, which has been defined for standard Dung-style argumentation frameworks. And it would be very interesting to see what happens with ZFs. Okay, thank you very much. This was it. And now I'm very much looking forward to your questions.